now. The guys from Book Buzz come in every Thursday, and Alan Jordan is with us this morning. Morning, Alan.
Morning, Ian. How are you?
I'm pretty good. Now, this the book this morning is one for every corporate chief executive to look at this one and say, let's ditch the morning meeting. This is Loose by Martin Thomas, The Future of Business is Letting Go. And this is essentially saying, look, all this top-down management, all the spreadsheets that we look at every day, let's just ditch those and start going back to basics.
Absolutely. And loose as a goose, as against tight as a drum. Interesting book by Martin Thomas, published in March of this year, so it's very topical, very up to date. And what it talks about is, it's really saying, look, you know, we've got to have more open ways of thinking and operating. And you can see that they're beginning to pervade the largest and most complex institutions. So the big, large multinationals that are highly bureaucratic have had to find ways to actually loosen up to deal with the digital age, to deal with social media. So it's giving a lot of examples that maybe we'll just talk a little bit about what the big guys are doing to deal with the new age that we're living in.
Yeah, I suppose, I mean, people would know Google, where, you know, any employee can walk into the office of the executives and say, here's my idea for a project, and they'll be let go. But for the big multinationals, I mean, they have lines of reporting, chains of command, you know, across various regions and products. Is that model finished now?
Well, it's certainly, there's signs that it has to change. Like, for example, McKinsey, as far back as, say, 2006, produced a report from CEOs that 50% of them then already recognized that they were overly centralized, they were slow, it was complex decision making. So those large organizations have had to find ways to break them down. Let me give you a couple of examples. Like, for example, Sony was very much a closed operation. The whole idea was you'd have a eureka moment, break out some type of information and kind of surprise the audience. Now it's all about engaging the audience. Hell, the audience want to be involved in designing the programs that you're making. So you really have to open up the old structures. Procter & Gamble, an absolute giant in consumer goods. Its website now actively asks you to promote your goods and services. It just did a new relaunch of Old Spice, which maybe some of your listeners might remember was the, next to Brute, was the cologne of choice. They did it all virally. They produced YouTube advertisements based on people coming in on Twitter. So they've seen about 110 million people have viewed that. So it's the whole media landscape is changing, as well as brands.
Yeah, he goes through examples of companies in this. I mean, Asda, the supermarket giant in the UK, I mean, that's an interesting one as well. I mean, obviously that's owned by Walmart, I mean, one of the biggest corporations in the world, and you would imagine that it's got, you know, lines of reporting and chains of command that stretch forever.
Yeah, and Asda actually took the leap from Walmart in the UK by just going online and actually encouraging the customers to let them know that you weren't as cheap as you say you are, so they can engage with the customers online. So again, it's all focused not on online business so much, just to make sure that your organization loosens up. Another example would be Cisco. Cisco found out they were taking 6 months to get a project off the ground through a business planning phase. They're now reduced it to 6 weeks. So the whole idea of loose is that you've just got to open up, you've got to be quicker to market, you've got to let the ideas flow. And that way then you've got to allow people in your organization to make decisions and maybe make mistakes.
Does he apply this only to corporations, or does it look at government and other agencies? I see Pope Benedict and Justin Bieber get a mention in here.
Yeah, actually, it's a very good point because, as again, it was published in 2011, so it was quite a piece of it dealing with David Cameron's Big Society. And what's going to be interesting for us in Ireland, if you look what's happening in the UK, how they're trying to get the public service to operate, to work smarter, it's a mirror of what we have to do here. The big question is, are they going to be able to do it? Will those organizations be able to change, to loosen up, to decentralize, to have local organizations and voluntary groups doing the work that maybe large monolith organizations are doing now? So it's going to be very interesting to see over the next year or two whether you can translate what's happening in business, which is the early adopters, will it ever move into the public service?
Just wondering, from the book, does he actually speak to some of the executives in these companies, or is he just giving them a template as to here's what to follow, or does he have any examples of the corporations that have changed?
Yeah, no, there's a lot of discussion. I mean, again, his previous book would have looked at the whole example of Dell and Microsoft and Apple. So it takes examples from Rang Xerox, which again, Al McCarthy, who's the CEO there, says, look, you've got to live with the outcome of a few bad decisions so that you don't miss a boatload of good opportunities. And the same for Procter & Gamble. And then also, if you look at Cisco, if you look at Sony PlayStation, so a huge amount of the large organizations are changing because they have to. The one interesting thing was, for us, like for in our personal day-to-day lives, there was a Belgian traffic planner. And again, He removed most of the traffic lights in a small town in Belgium because he felt that it absolved drivers of the need to think for themselves. And as a result, the town has fewer accidents as people grow more conscious of their driving. So there's a lot to be learned for socially as well as in the business environment.
It's very hard, though, for major organisations to change. I mean, if you look at any of the papers this morning, there's reports of Nokia, you know, one of those great companies that we all know, but its mobile phones aren't selling anymore because people have shifted to an iPhone or a smartphone and Android phones. I mean, is it possible for big organisations to change? Does it give any examples? As in Procter & Gamble will be one of them, but is that the one exception to the rule?
Not really, no. I mean, Dell and Michael Dell was recognised as being an absolute control freak. He would have said that himself. So they went through a whole change process. Same thing there. So it's very much command and control, getting some. That wasn't working. Sony was the same as well. Procter & Gamble the same. So they're all changing. It's interesting. There was an article yesterday on Twitter saying that Microsoft are going to buy Nokia's phone business for $16 billion. So it'll be interesting to see whether that information comes through. So there's no doubt big business, it's changing. There's not so much new thought in Lewis. It's more confirming that we already know. If you aren't agile and nimble enough, and in fairness, Jack Welch and GE, Bill Gates and Microsoft, Richard Branson always said as their organizations got more complex and more bigger and larger, that they wanted to have a small company feel so they can be nimbler on their feet and react to what's happening in the market.
Ditch the management consultants and follow the gut instinct.
Absolutely.
I'm sure the management consultants won't want to hear that. No. Alan Jordan from Buck Buzz, thank you very much for joining us this morning. Now.